Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to tonight's event. I welcome you on behalf of the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute to tonight's event, which is actually the second in a series of public discussions about cultural, economic, political, and political events that and topics that have a global impact, have a potential global impact. The first event was actually also in this space this academic year. This was a presentation by Gordon Brown, former Prime Minister of the UK, and he had a tremendously interesting discussion, presentation, and afterwards discussion with the public about the economic crisis of 2008 and 9 that actually continues in a way until today. That surely was an event, or is an event, of public and global importance. Tonight's presentation, tonight's event, is a panel discussion, and it regards the upcoming presidential elections in the United States at the end of this year. The panels of tonight consist of Robert Shrum, who was a major political advisor to the presidential campaign of John Kerry in 2004, and Steve Schmidt, who had a similar position in the presidential campaign of John McCain in 2008. And the panel discussions will be introduced to you by Rogan Kersh, who is professor of public policy at the Wagner Graduate School of Public Service at NYU New York. Let us, ladies and gentlemen, welcome our panel tonight.
Salaam alaikum. Good evening. And let me add my welcome to Reinders. My first visit to Abu Dhabi, indeed to the Middle East, came just days after the 2008 presidential election of Barack Obama, when my NYU Wagner colleague Bob Shrum and I flew over to discuss that race for an audience I vividly remember as being particularly sophisticated, energetic, and insightful. Looking forward to more of the same for you. The bar is high 4 years later. I thought that audience and that event boded wonderfully for the then fledgling NYU Abu Dhabi effort. And thanks to the remarkable work of so many of you here, most of all our esteemed NYU president, John Sexton, who's here tonight, that work has paid off beautifully. Now we stand a little over 7 months, 225 days to be exact, from the 2012 election, one with profoundly vital import for the United States' role in the world, including here in the Gulf, as well as America's economy and domestic politics. This is one event that needs no hype or overstatement. To help us see the road ahead, we have two of the great political strategists of our age here this evening. I want to introduce each briefly, and then we're off. I'll pose questions, as Reinert said, for 45 minutes or so, and then for the last 20, 25, 30 minutes, we'll open the floor to you all. It's a little difficult to see you, so raise your hand high when we come to the Q&A part. And I'll ask you then, please ask a question. If you have a long monologue, we have a half hour reception afterwards, and you can deliver that monologue directly to the gentleman here. Steve Schmidt is a New Jersey native whose first political involvement came as a teenager, handing out materials for the 1978 Bill Bradley for Senate campaign. His subsequent work has been exclusively for Republican candidates. He's also worked on Capitol Hill, I want to note, as well as for the National Republican Campaign Committee in the Bush White House, where his high-level duties included managing the Supreme Court nominations of Justice Alito and Chief Justice Roberts. So Steve Schmidt has seen American politics from the inside, from all our institutions. He took over the John McCain campaign in 2008 and quickly transformed it, as the New York Times said at the time, into a, quote, an elbows-out, risk-taking, disciplined machine. I suspect to Steve's chagrin, he is best known today for being played by Woody Harrelson in HBO's new and, in the US, very hot film, Game Change. This is quite an honor, although it may be tempered by the other characters Woody Harrelson has played. A basketball hustler, a serial killer, a bounty hunter, a zombie destroyer, a conspiracy nut, a delusional man who believes he is a superhero, and Larry Flint. Bob Shrum is a famed political strategist as well, of course, so much so that before the 2000-2004 presidential campaigns, Democratic candidates hoping to hire him held what the media called the Shrum primary. He steered the winners of those primaries, Al Gore and John Kerry, to the nomination, and has a remarkable array of successful senatorial, gubernatorial, mayoral and presidential campaigns before that. I would add a personal note to the encomiums we've all heard and read about Bob's career. Like other political veterans, Bob came to the academy to do a little teaching and write a book. The great surprise to those of us at NYU Wagner who have come to know and love Bob Shrum is that he became very quickly Wagner's most popular and effective teacher. In fact, we opened up a new politics of public policy track because of Bob's work, and those of you who are Sheikh Mohammed scholars here and NYU Abu Dhabi students who have studied with him will know that as well. And his book, the one he wrote at Wagner, called No Excuses, Concessions of a Serial Campaigner, is that rarest of achievements in the political realm, a really good read. All right, the two of you, I will begin by saying, faced off directly in the 2004 campaign, you've been on opposite sides your entire adult political lives. We live in a time when American party differences are as pronounced as they've ever been. I'm curious as an opening question about what you have to say about one another.
Steve is a very good friend, extraordinarily talented and perceptive. He has now entered the realm of legendhood, and that film will keep him there for a very long time to come. The McCain campaign was, in my view, in hopeless shape when he took it over. It actually acquired hope. I think if Sarah Palin had been minimally informed and there had not been an economic crisis, that election would have been very, very close, and Senator McCain came close to winning it. But I've gotten to know him a lot better in the last few years. He's not only insightful, but refreshingly candid about what he thinks is going on. And I should say, I used to think that, or believe that, the tradition of friendships across the aisle was dying out. I was a very close friend of Robert Novak's. Some people couldn't believe how that could possibly be the case, the conservative columnist. Went and spent time with him when he was very sick. And that friendship went back for me 30 years. But if people like Steve, and there are some other people, his friend Nicole Wallace, who I don't know particularly well, but people who, aside from Carvel and Madeline, who married each other, it's actually possible to have real friendships. And I don't know that one's friends should be picked by their politics. There are plenty of Democrats I'd a lot rather not be friends with. I mean, I can work with them, but I don't need to be friends with them. And in addition to that, Steve's a very generous person with his time. I think he would be an absolutely extraordinary teacher. I have to correct one thing Rogan said. The most popular teacher at Wagner is Rogan Kersh, but I'm happy to bring up the rear.
Elbows out, hard charging. I'm Bob Shrum.
Well, thank you for having me. It's great to be here. It's my first visit to the UAE, and it's an amazing and wonderful country, and delighted to be here with my good friend Bob Shrum. And I think when you look at American politics at a divisive time, it's important to remember that the political parties are not competing warring tribes. And I think it's important to remember that people that disagree with you on how to achieve a result are sincere patriots who love their country, who want to do good and want to do right. And I think Bob's entire career, which has been at the center of American politics for such a long time now, is testament to that. He's a wonderful man, extremely generous. When you get to know Bob and his wonderful wife, Otsi, and you get to know some of Bob's friends, you see how many different people Bob and his wife, through their generosity, how many lives they've touched. So he's a wonderful person, a person of great character, but also one of the most accomplished people who's ever worked in American politics, and arguably the most brilliant writer in the modern era of American politics, authoring some of the great political speeches. So one of the dysfunctions in American politics today is that it's become very difficult to look at your political opponent through the prism of, well, they want to have a good result, they want to advance the interests of the country, and we've come to a point where everybody's intentions are questioned, everyone's intentions are in doubt, and when you get to know someone of Bob's personal character and also love of the country, you understand he's an American patriot fighting for the causes he believes in, and I think anyone who works in politics, you admire that quality.
Remarkable thing to hear. Thanks to you both. Let me dial it up a bit. The 2012 election marks the first in a long time that neither Bob Shrum nor Steve Schmidt is involved directly with the party's nominee. That means both of you are relatively free to share your views of how this one's going. I'm wondering if you could each start with some general impressions about the campaign so far. I'm going to get to questions about the future, but if you could just count, many of the audience may not follow it as closely as we do. Give us a general snapshot on where we are thus far and how we got here.
Well, have you all heard the story of Mitt Romney's dog, Seamus? This was the Irish setter that they had that 20 years ago, they were going to Canada on a family vacation, and he strapped the dog to the roof of the car.
In a cage.
I'm not sure it made it better for Seamus, but anyway, he was in a cage, and of course, there was one unanticipated consequence of this, which occurred several times, that required the hosing down of the car on the trip to Canada. I think what's happened in the Republican Party is...
That was a metaphor.
No, it was a reality. I think what's happened in the Republican Party is that Romney, in a sense, has strapped the Republican primary voters to the roof of the car. And he's driving it to the nomination, and he's going to get there. Why do I say they're strapped to the roof of the car? Because they don't really want him. He has huge money advantages, but they have incredible doubts about him. They doubt his sincerity as a conservative. They doubt his character. They doubt, I think to some extent, now you're getting this from Republican professionals, his qualities as a politician, his capacity to communicate or relate to people. But he's going to be the nominee because aside from, well, I'll get to it in a second, he's had trouble getting through this and beating opponents who look like they were recruited from the cast of Monty Python's Flying Circus. I mean, if you think about Herman Cain, you think about Newt Gingrich, you think about Rick Santorum, who is an impossible president. The one guy who ran, who could, I think, not only have given him a strong run, but would have beaten him, is Rick Perry, the governor of Texas. Had he been competent in those debates, I think would now probably have the Republican nomination all but sewed up, because the base felt much more comfortable with him. The other thing that's happened to Romney in this process is he's been pulled to the right. He entered it with a flip-flop problem. You know, somebody who had been strongly for abortion rights, somebody who said in 1994 that he was more pro-gay rights than Kennedy. There was a wonderful line in the 94 debate that Senator Kennedy had with him where he looked at Romney and said, "You're not pro-choice, you're multiple choice." And that's been played on television a number of times, and it's all been reinforced. And so I think Romney enters this with a character problem, and he's got 225 days to fix this. And once he secures the nomination, it's going to get better. But right now, he's upside down with independents. He's upside down in terms of approval ratings with voters in general, to a degree that John McCain never was, John Kerry never was, Al Gore never was, George W. Bush never was. And that's the price the primary process has exacted on him. He's outspent Santorum at least, I would think, 10 to 15 to 1. And he's going to get the nomination, and yet we still wait on Wisconsin. You know, is it possible that in Wisconsin next Tuesday, Santorum will win? I don't think so. I think Republicans are settling into accepting him, but they're reluctant riders on the roof of the car.
Well, the good news, if you're a Republican, is that both sides start out in this general election with roughly 47% of the vote. It's a closely divided country. Structurally, the election will be close, and President Obama has every capacity to lose the election in November. That being said, it's been a very, very strange primary season that has more closely resembled a reality television show than it has a traditional election. And the good news is that in a couple of years, the Democratic candidates will go through a process also that looks like a reality show. But on any given Tuesday night, there's been 20 plus debates that have taken place over the duration of this never-ending primary campaign. And putting aside the news value, which on any given night was very minimal, it's been the most entertaining thing on television as you watch this incredible cast of characters who stand up there wanting to be president of the United States. And you know, it looks more like on any given night that you have candidates for the president of Mars, where Newt Gingrich wants to build a colony. So you've had a process that has had a very negative effect on the standing of the candidates. You had a historic election in 2008 where the tension in that race for Democrats was they liked both of the historic candidates in the race, the first African-American, Barack Obama, and the first serious woman candidate. And when that process, which was a tough, long race, ended, both of them were viewed favorably by many more people who viewed them unfavorably. And it's just been the opposite over the course of the Republican primary. As Bob points out, you know, Governor Romney is now badly what we in politics call upside down, where many more people view him unfavorably than favorably. It's been a very negative campaign. The attacks have been very personal. The character question has been entered into the race in a meaningful way, because the Republicans are saying the exact same thing that the Democrats are, that Mitt Romney will say anything at any time to anyone if he believes it will advantage him politically. And that has really permeated the American electorate. And so Republicans are in a tough spot for a lot of different reasons coming into the general election, but saved by the fact that it remains a closely divided country.
Back in the 1972 campaign, Richard Nixon's reelection effort raised large individual contributions, $100,000 from Howard Hughes, $200,000 from a guy named Robert Vesco. One of the results of this uncovery was major campaign finance legislation passed in 1974 with the idea that no single person would ever influence a race with that much giving again. Yet this year, to take one example, the casino magnate Sheldon Adelson has given $16.5 million and counting to Newt Gingrich. Could you guys talk a bit about the rise of super PACs? Has the Citizens v. United decision changed campaigning forever?
Well, I think that the Citizens United decision, which was a result of the McCain-Feingold campaign finance legislation, which a lot of us at the time said was unconstitutional, that it would be overturned by the Supreme Court, and it would have a terrible effect. And the effect that all of the campaign finance legislation has had since 1976 in the country is it has pulled money away from the candidate committees and away from the political parties. The political parties in American political history have always been stabilizing institutions and moderating institutions. The Democratic Party, with more liberals than conservatives, but it was a party that was a coalition party of liberals, moderates, and conservatives. The Republican Party was a party, a coalition of more conservatives, but also with liberal and moderate members in it. And the goal of a political party is to be in the majority. As the money has been pulled out of the political parties, it's gone on both sides to ideological groups who are increasingly trying to enforce ideological discipline. That's why it's impossible to have an honest debate about the fiscal condition of the country or an honest debate about reforming taxes in the country. And increasingly now, you have a stable of billionaires who are playing in the presidential race like they would play at a high roller table in Las Vegas, placing the chips on various presidential candidates. In a lot of cases with these super PACs, the money is undisclosed. No one knows where it's coming from. There's a total lack of transparency. Lack of transparency drives cynicism in the process. And the cynicism in American politics and in the country is at a very high level right now. So the campaign finance structure in the country is just absolutely fundamentally broken. And it is pulling the extremes in both parties to the center, and it's a problem.
I don't see any chance for any significant campaign finance reform in a direction that would undo Citizens United in the immediate future. I think that, first of all, you can't undo Citizens United except by a constitutional amendment,
right,
or by the Supreme Court reconsidering it. And there is a case from Montana right now where there's going to be an argument made that the court's original finding that this doesn't have a corrupting influence can be proven wrong from Montana. I doubt very much Justice Kennedy will change his vote. So as long as we have this Supreme Court, I don't think things are going to move. And I think Democrats have a little bit of a disadvantage here, not only because there are more people with more resources who are willing to set up these independent committees for Republicans, but because Democrats are squeamish about this. So the Democratic Super PAC has had a lot of trouble raising money and is not competitive. And Sheldon Adelson, who has poured $16.3 million into what Steve and I call the Newt and Callista Gingrich happiness tour across America, where at the expense of their contributors, they're eating in every fine restaurant and enjoying themselves while he's getting no votes. He's told people...
It's great work if you can get it.
I mean, you know, he's become in our politics the equivalent of a Macy's hot air balloon. He's just not a serious figure anymore. But he's living off this money. But Adelson has said he's thinking about putting $100 million into the general election. In 2004, Grover Norquist, who is the head of the anti-tax Turkomatas of the Republican Party and has a lot of influence in that party, commented after the election that George Soros had said, well, he had spent $24 or $27 million trying to elect John Kerry on an independent expenditure, and Norquist's reaction was, $24 or $27 million? The guy has, you know, $10 billion, $15, $20 billion. If he really cared, why didn't he spend $100 million and it would have worked? I think you will see independent expenditure PACs, these super PACs that will spend huge amounts of money in the general election, and I think that will help Republicans more than it will help Democrats. It will do one other thing that Steve referred to, which is the whole reality show nature of this, I think will be carried into the general election, not because Romney's not a serious person, and certainly not because the president's not a serious person, but because you're going to have all these people out there producing this stuff, and it's going to be coming into your living room, and it's going to be a three-ring circus, or to use the phrase that John Sexton came up with about 10 years ago, the Coliseum culture is going to dominate this election. I mean, the one thing that might break through all that are the debates.
I'll give you an example. In the state of California, the cost of advertising is $4 million a week to be able to deliver a message into the living rooms of the California voters. So $16 million a month, and you're going to want to be on television for 3 or 4 months. The federal limits are $2,300 per contributor. Right. So there's not enough people to write checks to go out and raise, if you're a candidate, you know, the $40, $50, $60 million you need to raise to run a competitive election. So increasingly the candidates themselves have the smallest voice in the actual campaign, and you have these interest groups, or the interest groups which are front groups for wealthy individuals out there consuming all of the space in the election, and it's incredibly unhealthy. This will be the first year where you see in the congressional races and in the U.S. Senate races, in that most of the competitive races, the smallest voice will be the voice of the candidates. And when the candidates have the smallest voice in their own election, that's a sign of great unhealthiness in the process.
Let me shift from this drowning, if you will, of the candidates' voices, as you've both described, and this major change, I think, in 2012 to this individual contribution and so on, to another arguable shift even since 2008, and that's the rise of the Twitterverse and the Tumblrverse and the Redditverse and all these forms of social media that have accelerated, which hardly seem possible, our campaigning. Is that a significant change in ways that would be difficult to deal with if you were at the helm of one of these?
Well, Twitter, I think, has become a real tool for every campaign. I mean, when Eric Fernstrom, Romney's communications director, said on a TV show the other morning that there was no problem with re-engineering him for a general election so that he could be a little more moderate, because he was just an etch-a-sketch, and you just, you know, those things where you can make little figures and by turning things around. That was tweeted out immediately, and got picked up by absolutely everybody. Everybody went for the film. It became the dominant story of the day. I mean, you know, whatever the big problems the country has, whether it's Iran, the size of the debt, the slow recovery, this dominated the news. And I think the use of Twitter is going to go on, but it too can be a trivializing instrument in this process. I mean, I haven't thought about it until you asked the question, but something that only allows you to send out 140 characters doesn't invite a lot of serious debate about big issues. But we've empowered people through this. It's going to be there, and it's going to have a very large impact. I think that a lot of the other social media, like Facebook, the internet itself, actually are tending to some extent democratize fundraising. You got the big Citizens United thing on one side, but you also have what started actually with Howard Dean, then was picked up by Kerry in 2004, so that Kerry raised $150 million, much of it from fairly small contributions before the convention. Then Obama raised a huge amount of money last time, much of it from small contributions. That's the one counterweight to the thing you're seeing from Citizens United. But every cycle sees this notching up. I don't see any reason. As long as people are still inventing this stuff, political people are going to figure out how to use it.
Sure.
Look, we're in the middle of a communication revolution that's had a profound impact on this region of the world in the last year as well. 20 years ago, there were 5 national newspapers in the United States, 3 television networks, and CNN. And the way that campaigns communicated was through advertising. Mm-hmm. It was a one-way conversation. What mattered is what the candidates and the campaign said about the candidate and said about the other candidate. People sat in their living rooms and they processed those ads, decided which side was credible, which side was not, and went and made their vote. The net effect of Facebook and Twitter and the social media revolution is that everybody who wants to control the conversation has lost control of the conversation. And now you're in a never-ending conversation with a feedback loop from 100+ million people in the country where everyone has a position. So Mitt Romney, for example, who's been on both sides of many different issues, can go out and talk about the fact that he's been steady, he's been consistent, but when you have 20 million people on their Twitters laughing about it, or when you go out, as Bob points out, with 140 characters, it's very difficult to talk about tax reform or the fiscal condition of the country in 140 characters, but you can certainly talk about Donald Trump or Seamus the Irish Setter or, you know, a lot of other trivial issues. So it has the net effect of the campaigns have lost control of the conversation, and campaigns that are successful are ones that understand that and try to steer the raft down the rapids. But the other part of it is it trivializes it, and it simplifies the really complex issues.
Democratizing and trivializing, sometimes hard to separate the two.
Exactly.
Both of you have been called in to either rescue or give strategic advice at vital moments over the years in different campaigns. I'm going to ask you both to do that now. I'm going to ask Bob Shrum to give Mitt Romney some advice going forward, I'm going to ask Steve Schmidt to give Barack Obama's campaign some advice going forward. I'm going to flip you two and get you to go at it.
Well, if I had really good advice to give to Mitt Romney, I wouldn't offer it.
Just us talking here.
It might get repeated. Look, I think they need to get, they need to do a paradoxical thing. They need to increase their message discipline while also allowing Romney to look like a natural human being. Right now he looks like an animatronic figure. He does, and because he's been so closely tethered to the script that they've written for him that in those debates, in which he's pretty good actually, he doesn't come across as a real human being. People don't like him, they don't warm to him. And yet when he slips the surly bonds of his handlers, he says things like, I like to fire people, or I'll bet you $10,000. I mean, we could go on and on with the examples. And the result of that is, there's nothing wrong with being rich. And there's no reason that people can't believe that a candidate who is very wealthy cares about them. I mean, witness FDR, witness JFK.
Sure.
But Romney through, you know, sort of, how do you go to a NASCAR event and people say, well, are you a NASCAR fan? You say, not really, but I have a lot of friends who own NASCAR teams. So the most important thing they can do is, I think, once they're past this, is take some time with him, get the message box into his head, and help him learn to talk more naturally and less self-consciously, because people want to actually relate to these folks.
Sure.
One of the most interesting statistics is, except for the Obama-Clinton race, and I agree with Steve, the Democrats' problem there was they wanted to nominate both of them. The Republicans' problem this year is they don't want to nominate any of them. Except for that, everybody else who's won a nomination has sewed this thing up much faster.
Right.
That was true with George W. Bush in 2000. It was true with Kerry. It was true with Gore. It was true with George Bush in 1988. So this thing has been protracted. Once Romney gets out of this, and they never planned for this kind of thing to go on this long, they got to get him some time to get centered, to understand what his positive message is, because I don't. I mean, I'm a CEO who can fix America, may not work as in if the economy continues to get better. So they're going to have some time to make him both, if this is possible, more contained and more spontaneous.
Let Romney be Romney, just not too much.
Yes.
Okay. 47-47, you got a president with some bumps and bruises and possibly an improving economy. What do you tell him?
It's very interesting is that if you look at the arc of the president's approval numbers over the last 6 months, really the most uncovered story in American politics has been the political recovery of the president, who went from approval ratings that were in the low 40s, which is very dangerous territory, to numbers that have gone back up to 48, 49, 50%, which is right around where we were in the Bush campaign. And for an incumbent president, the ballot, the amount of votes you get, is going to mirror that approval rating at the end of the day. So it was interesting as you watched over the last couple of weeks, the president really for the first time began to engage in the race politically. He went out and he took some shots at the Republican opponents. The campaign turned on a little bit, started to engage. You have the White House, of course, in Washington. You have the campaign headquarters in Chicago. The campaign is staffed, it's ready to go, it's raising money, they want to get in on the action. But as soon as the campaign engaged and the president engaged in politics, there were three polls out that showed his numbers dropping. So it will be interesting to watch that over the next couple of months. And I would say that he's in a much better position focusing on governing the country. It's powerful for a president when he's in, for example, as he is this week, he's in South Korea.
Yeah.
attending to his official duties. Because if you look at the body of all the polling data that's out there, people in the United States, although they're in a slightly better mood than they were 7 months ago, they're still in a terrible mood. They're sick of politics, they don't like the political parties, they don't like the Congress, and anyone who is behaving like a politician, which of course when you start getting in there and mixing it up with your opponents, that's the definition of it, you are likely to pay a price. So it will be interesting to see if the president is in a better position by disengaging from the campaign for as long as possible, leaning back, practicing a Rose Garden strategy, mm-hmm. as opposed to leaning into the fight. And because I think there's some evidence to suggest that he doesn't benefit by getting into a fight with these guys right now.
Great. Thanks for reversing roles. Let's see if it helps the other side of this case. I want to turn to two or three big issues and look at them through the prism of the fall campaign. How important are these issues going to be? How does each campaign handle them? Can take them in, or take whichever likely candidate on the Republican side you like. But let's start with health reform. The Supreme Court begins hearing arguments tomorrow, a virtually unprecedented 5.5 hours of oral argument over 3 days on Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act. How big an issue will this in fact be in the fall campaign?
Well, I think if Mitt Romney's the nominee, it's very difficult for him to attack President Obama on the individual mandate because of his past record on it. If, in fact, the Supreme Court says that this is an unconstitutional law and parts of the health reform are tossed out or all of it is tossed out, it will really focus attention with a lot of energy on the Democratic side on the issue of judicial appointments and the Supreme Court, and there'll be, I believe, tremendous intensity around the issue if it's tossed out on the Democratic side. It will be evidence if you're a Democrat, although I would disagree with this, but it'll be evidence if you're a Democrat of an activist, conservative judiciary, and all of a sudden this will become a huge issue in the race, particularly with what I think has been a disaster for Republicans as a result of the Rick Santorum candidacy. If the Democrats are able to go out through health reform and make an argument about we need to stop an activist conservative judiciary from weighing in on all manner of women's health issues, contraception, abortion, you'll really energize the female electorate in the country on issues that have nothing to do with health care, but are energized because of the health care Supreme Court ruling.
First, I should say, we're here to talk about politics. The Supreme Court has lots of ways not to decide this issue right. now. And in fact, there's a federal statute that would appear to indicate that they shouldn't be deciding the law until it goes into effect. I hope they don't decide it in the middle of an election year. I think it would be bad for the court. I think the court took a real blow in 2000. Put aside whether you agree or disagree with the decision. It was perceived as very political by the country, so I hope they don't do it. I think the decision rides with one caveat on Justice Kennedy as the swing vote, although I think if he decided to uphold the law, that Chief Justice Roberts might move for the sake of the court and because he can then write the opinion. I don't know that. If it's thrown out, I agree with Steve, it will energize women. The Republicans will then actually have to face a big question, which is, what do you want to do about health care? And right now, their whole answer has been, we want to get rid of Obamacare, but make sure people are taken care of. Suddenly, Obamacare will be gone. It will be a big question. Thirdly, I think that I want to reinforce Steve's point, actually. I've always said I hope Roe v. Wade never gets overturned. But I also know that if Roe v. Wade ever got overturned, the women's vote for Democrats would be huge. I mean, when they thought there was a kind of threat after the Casey decision leading into 1992, women overwhelmingly voted Democratic. And he's right about Santorum and the effect Santorum's had. I think I saw a number today that among unmarried women, Democrats are now ahead, or Obama's ahead of Romney, who after all didn't start this. He just had to agree with some of it, because otherwise he would lose the right wing that he has to get to have the nomination, ahead by 17 points suddenly. And they had actually been pretty close to even in the 2010 midterm elections. So yeah, this is something that a wise Supreme Court, I think, would have put off till after the election.
Move from inside US baseball to something that's more pertinent, one might say, here in the Gulf. How does Iran play in the fall election?
I don't think we have any idea. What is the Israeli calculation? What does the Israeli intelligence actually say?
Right.
Do they think that they have more leverage to do something now because the president can't, it's harder for him to try and restrain them given the potential political fallout. On the other hand, it's a coalition government. Do elements of the coalition government say we shouldn't be doing this right now and we shouldn't endanger our relationship with the U.S.? The one thing I will say is if something happens, I think the results are to some extent predictable and in the most important respects unpredictable. The predictable result is that there will be a major international crisis. I think Iran might very well try to close the Straits of Hormuz. I think that the president under those circumstances would probably use the Navy to open the Straits of Hormuz, and I don't think there'd be much of an Iranian Navy left at that point. And I also, there's a long history in the U.S. if there's an international crisis, even if it causes some economic disruption, which we all forget the Gulf War caused economic disruption at the time. But when Bush was leading that coalition, he suddenly was at, 91% approval. Now, Obama's not going to get there, but if something happened and he responded to it and appeared to respond with strength, I think it would be a tremendous rallying around him in terms of the country. There is a lot of loose talk in the Republican primary process that I think is dangerous and actually scary to Americans, which seems to say we want to go to war right away. The American people don't have an appetite to go to war with Iran. So I assume that Romney, once he's the nominee, will try to modulate that. But I don't think it's been helpful to Republicans.
I agree with everything that Bob just said. I would just add that when we talk about what's going to happen in a presidential election, we tend to talk about it through the prism of events that have already occurred.
Sure.
And I think in this election, the outcome is going to be shaped pretty dramatically by events that have yet to occur. In the Eurozone, in the Gulf, and in the American economy.
Right.
And by Gulf, we mean the Arabian Gulf.
Let the record show. I'm going to leave other issue questions to audience members who have particular ones. And in the last couple questions I have for you, I'm going to ask you to do something that is difficult, but we do it all the time, and that's take out the crystal ball. Let's look ahead and ask you both to offer a prediction about should, as we've been assuming here, Romney winning, who his vice presidential nominee will be, first of all, and then what you think the outcome in the fall, 225 days away, I recognize, will hinge on.
Why don't we split those and do the vice presidential
nominee first? Vice president first, and then we'll...
Steve, you want to start? I think you should start.
I told my wife I would never, ever weigh in on the question of who should be vice president ever again. But
outside the UAE, I think you said.
Look, I think if you look at the Republican Party in the United States, if we had a deliberate strategy to antagonize the fastest growing demographic in the country, the Hispanic voter, we couldn't possibly have done a better job over the last 20 years. And a constituency of Americans that is the number one contributor of service to the United States military, that culturally belongs in the Republican Party, that's entrepreneurial, that's family-oriented, that Ronald Reagan got 40+% of the vote. George Bush, George W. Bush got over 40% of the vote. You have so much intemperate comments directed by Republican members of Congress on immigration, on a huge number of issues, that it's not possible as a math equation for Republicans to win the election with 16% or 20% of the Hispanic vote. And it's not possible to win the election without carrying Florida, New Mexico, Nevada as a practical matter. You can move the, you can work the math around a lot of different ways, but as a practical matter. So you have a first-term Hispanic governor in the state of New Mexico named Susana Martinez. She will be on the short list for consideration. You have a Hispanic Republican governor in the state of Nevada named Brian Sandoval. He will be on the list. And you have, in the state of Florida, you have a superstar, you know, viewed very much in the same way by Republicans that President Obama was viewed by Democrats when he was Senator Obama. You have Marco Rubio. And then you have in the state of Ohio, another important state, someone who's not flashy, not particularly charismatic, but unquestionably qualified to be vice president, to take the oath of office if necessary, Rob Portman, former head of the OMB, now a United States Senator, longtime member of Congress. But I think that it will be, you know, I think those four are really strong potential candidates, and it will not be Rick Santorum, it won't be Rick Perry, it won't be Michelle Bachmann, it won't be any of these people who have been in the, you know, reality show contestants.
Fascinating, given the tradition of nominating somebody who ran against you in the primary. Interesting that none of the ones you mentioned are from
I think there was a different tradition, and I think it will be adhered to here. I agree with Steve's list. I would add, by the way, that Chris Christie will not be the nominee, because I don't think that would, I don't think they carry New Jersey. So it's not clear to me what it brings you. And I doubt Rob Portman will be the nominee unless one of these other three somehow or other can't make it across the hurdle, because 16% of the Hispanic vote, which is what Romney's getting right now, means you're going to lose the election, period. Now, it's not clear that picking a Hispanic running mate is going to get you to that 40%. It's, you're still going to have to talk the issues and have a way that you're going to connect with people that they think matters. If I can step back from the individuals, I think the people who have done best in this process of picking vice presidents over the years have gotten rid of all the extraneous arguments. I'm going to be overshadowed, you know. Who cares if you're overshadowed? You get to be, they call you Mr. President. Call the other guy Mr., the other person Mr. Vice President, or Madam Vice President, or Miss Vice President, whatever we're going to do when we finally have one. And they pick the person who can help them most win the election. It is not a question of whether or not they like them. Franklin Roosevelt didn't like John Nance Garner. But John Nance Garner was critical to his getting the nomination. It also helped put the Democratic coalition together. I don't believe that John Kennedy especially wanted to pick Lyndon Johnson, but I know for a fact that well before the convention, he and his father had decided that was who had to be vice president. Ronald Reagan did not want to pick George H.W. Bush. It was a very, very smart pick. So I think you pick the person who can help you win the election. I have one caveat to that, and it relates to the candidates that Steve discussed. People have to vet, and they have to get past a fairly rigorous process. And the mistakes that are made are always different. So you've got to have a vetting process that asks questions you wouldn't necessarily think had to be asked. In 1972, when there wasn't much of a formal vetting process, and Senator McGovern asked Senator Eagleton, it just didn't occur to anybody that he should say, by the way, have you ever been treated for mental illness? It just, that wasn't one of the questions you thought you had to ask. I think in the case of John McCain, there was an assumption that if somebody had the word governor appended to their name, that they knew basic facts about, no, I'm serious, about who, for example, we had fought in World War II, that they had some sense of the geography of the world and of the power relationships of the world. Not that they had a deep sense, but they had some sense, and you got to satisfy yourself about that. My guess is Sandoval, who was a federal prosecutor, and Susana Martinez, who was a federal prosecutor, either know that stuff, and Rubio, I think, clearly knows it, either know that stuff or they can pick it up pretty fast. You've also got to do the financial vetting.
Sure.
I mean, there are stories that Rubio may have some problems. And the one thing you don't want to do, and Walter Mondale could tell you this, Steve, well, the HBO is telling the world this, you don't want to spend a bunch of time in September and early October dealing with problems related to your running mate.
Sure.
So I agree that you got to try to reach for someone who can help you with the Hispanic vote. That's a critical imperative, but you got to make sure the person passes muster.
But I would add, it's interesting to me, you know, when I'm on television talking about this, particularly after the experience of the last 4 years, not one person has ever asked this question in the media through the prism of who's best qualified to be president, to take the oath of office, which has happened many times in American history. It's who will benefit most politically, transactionally. And clearly, when you look at the tumultuous times that we live in, I think it's very, very important that person be prepared on day one to take the oath of office.
You know, it's interesting if you think about it. I named the people that I thought were picked because they would most help. And guys put their ego aside. Roosevelt was secure enough. Reagan was secure enough. Kennedy was secure enough. They actually probably, in all three of those cases, picked the person next best qualified to be president. But it will also happen to be the person who helped them win the election.
Right.
If you don't, you've got to focus. Now, look, you can pick people and assume that they're going to do things they're not going to do. I mean, we picked Edwards in 2004, and don't think of the Edwards of today, think of the Edwards of then. The entire party wanted him picked. And it's clear in retrospect, A, he didn't perform in the debate against Cheney, which everybody assumed he would,
sure.
And B, he didn't get us anything politically, and C, he certainly didn't meet your standard about who was best picked qualified.
Right.
Dick Gephardt, who probably did meet that standard, might have helped us carry Missouri, would have been tough, and certainly would have helped us in Ohio, which we lost by a very little bit, and which made the difference in the election. So even when you try to go about this in the most thorough way, you can make mistakes.
Sure.
Now you want to do the other question?
Last question from me, which is merely crystal balling again, and we've covered a handful of issues, at least healthcare and Iran, Middle East issues. That will have a role in the election, but looking ahead at what the election might hinge on, what kinds of major factors, if you're a strategist, are you keeping your eye on every day, along with the American economy, which, as we said, looks like it's on something of an upward trajectory?
Well, leaving the economy aside, and we've already touched on Iran, the region, the Eurozone, those kinds of things, I think the debates are going to be far more important than they usually are, and they're usually very important, because it's a chance for Romney to humanize himself, to go toe-to-toe with the president, to pass the bar, for people to say, gee, I kind of like that guy, and he's speaking to me about things I care about. And Obama has a problem with the debates, and it's a problem Gore had in 2000 in a way.
Mm.
The expectations for Gore going into those 2000 debates were sky high.
Right.
And the expectations for Obama going into these debates will be sky high. And if Romney holds his own, it will really help him. You never want your expectations to get out of control. It used to frustrate Gore like crazy that some anonymous aide would say, wait till we get Bush in a debate.
Right.
And then we did, of course, and it wasn't very helpful. And he used to say, can somebody shut these people up? This happened to Romney in 94. He kept challenging Kennedy to a debate. We didn't want to debate him because By then, the worker ads were on. We were winning by 12, 13 points. And finally, he got what he wished for. He got a debate, and Kennedy crushed him in the debate. And that sort of sealed the election. Mm. But I think the debate will be a really important thing. I also think the Republican convention is going to be really important, because Romney's going to be under a lot of pressure to let people speak who could do great damage to his campaign. George H.W. Bush, the first President Bush, I think was nearly mortally wounded by Pat Buchanan. Right. Monday night of the 1992 convention, Ronald Reagan night. And that's what everybody was supposed to focus on. Instead, they focused on, they let him, Pat Buchanan, speak in prime time, and he gave this sulfurous speech which alienated women, which promoted prejudice, which led people to say, I don't want anything to do with this party. And the truth is, and I don't know how this happened, I asked somebody once, the Bush people saw the text in advance and still let him give it because they thought they had to let him give it. So yeah, I'd keep Rick Santorum out of prime time, and I wouldn't care what he said. I certainly wouldn't put Newt Gingrich in prime time. And you can't put Ron Paul in prime time standing up there, you know, throwing out all these goofy ideas about the economy and the gold standard. So scripting and controlling the Republican convention's critical. We didn't win in 2004, as I am acutely and painfully aware, but that convention was very carefully scripted. It was where Barack Obama emerged as a major force. Their 2004 convention was very carefully scripted. It was held in New York. It echoed 9/11 even when it didn't mention it. They're going to have to run a very, I have no doubt the Democratic convention will be like No Drama Obama. It will be carefully scripted. Sure. It will be done. It will be targeted. It'll be interesting to see how the Romney people respond to the pressures. They would have been in real trouble if they had to bargain to get the last few delegates for the nomination. I don't think they'll have to, so they've got more freedom.
No, look, I think on the Republican side, you're worried about a Star Wars bar scene at the convention. These conventions are just hugely important. And so you said however many days are left to the actual election, you have, you know, a couple of days that are just absolutely uneven in their level of importance against the rest. And those are the three presidential debates and the vice presidential debate. And then the nights of the convention. And one of those nights, Romney will give his speech. One of those nights, the vice presidential candidate will give their speech. And then you have the two other nights. Who's going to speak for the party? In 2004, that Tuesday night, the big night, which was a huge night, Arnold Schwarzenegger spoke, Rudolph Giuliani spoke, and John McCain spoke. Those are all people that in today's Republican Party, you know, if you were to put forward the moderate foot of the party to the public, which I think is an important thing to do at the conventions for the general population, and particularly the people that will decide the outcome of the election, I think the base of the party would go nuts. I guarantee you Sarah Palin's going to want to speak in prime time at the convention. What do you do if you're the Romney campaign? I think it's a disaster if she speaks in prime time at the convention. You know, Rick Santorum's going to want to have a big speech in prime time at the convention. And so there's going to be, and I suspect you're at the front end of some pretty vigorous arguments that are taking place, you know, within the Romney campaign about how they're going to approach it, how they're going to do it. And then, of course, these debates. You know, so much of what's going to happen in the campaign is just silliness. But the debate audience, I suspect, is going to be between 80 million to 100 million people for these debates. They're going to be the most watched debates in the history of presidential politics. People are going to tune in. The commentary that's going to follow them is going to be enormously important. And those debates will decide the election, because all the rest of this stuff, dogs on roofs, Etch-a-sketches, the attacks, the ads, will all fade away.
By the way, in terms of the convention, I think it'll be very interesting to see which side wins the argument internally in the Romney campaign. Yeah. Will it be the people who say, we got to keep the base, whatever the price, so maybe we won't let Sarah do it, but maybe we'll let Rick do it, or vice versa? Mm. Or will the side win that says, look, it's okay if we lose some of the base. Some of these people are going to be mad at us anyway. We got to go out there and try to win the election. There's a theory about that a very good friend of mine, I don't know if he wants his name mentioned, who's a Republican strategist, gave me, which I happen to agree with totally right now. If Romney wins the Republican nomination and loses the election, you're going to have a Republican Party where the base is going to say they did it to us again. They stuck us with this moderate guy. I don't think Romney's particularly moderate, by the way. They stuck us with this moderate guy, and we lost. And so in 2016, we're going to demand our guy. And it may not be until they get their guy, and it will be a guy, unless it's Sarah Palin, it may not be until they get their guy and they are administered a very thorough beating that they rethink themselves to the point where you can imagine a Republican Party again that would take a whole night of its convention and have three people thought of as moderates, mm-hmm. two of whom were pro-choice, as the prime speakers that night.
My question directly goes to foreign policy issues. Do you think if either of the candidates win, whether Obama once again reelected or the Republicans, either of Romney or Santorum, do they have a strategic vision for Asia, particularly to China? And what advice would you like to give? I don't know whether you want to give an advice to the Republicans or not, but Obama's has his own vision. Can you elaborate on that? Thank you very much.
Well, first, Santorum won't win. He's not going to be the nominee. I wouldn't think twice about it. I think that's done. And I suppose if somehow or other he does emerge as the nominee, I'll come back here and I'll race around Saadiyat Island five times, which for me would be very unusual. I think Obama has a largely unarticulated, mm-hmm. externally, vision of the U.S.-China relationship, which he sees as competitive in some respects, but fundamentally and essentially cooperative, that the Chinese consumer market will become very important to American production and American jobs. He doesn't want confrontation with China. He wants to let this new guy, Xi, who's going to take over, move the reform process along. It won't satisfy all the human rights folks. It won't satisfy me. But I think he sees in very real power terms what has to be done. I don't know what Romney thinks. Normally, I would think he would share that kind of view. But he's been forced during this primary process into a lot of China bashing. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that if he became president, he would engage in it. Bill Clinton did a fair amount of it in 1992 and then built a pretty productive relationship with China. I think that I have no doubt that Obama has a serious policy, will pursue a serious policy, and that it will be very effective. And I have some reason to think that on this, although not on many other things, on this I think Romney would be pretty sensible. My fear about Romney, by the way, is I happen to share the view that we have no idea what his core beliefs are. And he has flip-flopped all over the place. But unlike Ronald Reagan, who got elected as the paladin of true conservatives, he's not going to have any flexibility. Ronald Reagan could raise taxes when he had to. He could make a deal on Social Security with Tip O'Neill. He could make a deal on immigration reform with Ted Kennedy. And he could basically end the Cold War with Mikhail Gorbachev while he was being criticized. George Will wrote a column saying he's totally selling out what we believed, and the base could care less. They said, if it's okay with Ronald Reagan, it's okay with us. I don't think Romney has that flexibility. I think if he gets elected, on a lot of these issues, China's a bit esoteric, but on a lot of these issues that he's talked about and given commitments on, he's going to have to keep those commitments, because otherwise he will face a primary for renomination in 2016 if he gets elected?
For the foreseeable future, particularly with a weak economy, the tradition of American politics is going to be that candidates who are challenger candidates running against an incumbent president or in an open seat like there was last time will gleefully bash China as candidates, and it will continue right up to the moment where they take the oath of office and have actual responsibilities.
I thank you for a most interesting discussion. I'm wondering two questions, one for the Democrat. People I talk to have really no enthusiasm. Well, let me put it a little differently. A lot of progressive people have very minimal enthusiasm for Obama right now, feeling that he's moderate, he's too easy to make a deal, that sort of thing. So I hear a lot of people saying we don't see any real difference. What if it's Romney? What if it's Obama? What difference does it make? So that's my question for the Democrat. For the Republican, I wonder, do you think the Tea Party would pull out of the Republican Party and try to make a third force? Or how do you see moving ahead when you've got the Tea Party to deal with? Thank you very much.
Yeah, I have minimal tolerance for those Democrats and progressives who have minimal enthusiasm for Obama. I think it is a snare and a delusion to believe that it doesn't make any difference whether he wins or Romney wins. Just look at the Supreme Court, for example. In 1960, I think it was Eric Severide who made the comment, there's not much difference between Kennedy and Nixon. And Arthur Schlesinger immediately wrote a little book, Kennedy or Nixon, Does It Make Any Difference?, which was a persuasive book. And I think in retrospect, you could look back and say, it probably did make a big difference on certain issues, for example, like civil rights. Obama was, for the first 3 years of his presidency, the opposite of the critique that he received from Hillary Clinton and to an extent from the McCain campaign in 2008. They said he was going to be all speech and no substance. He became all substance and no speech. And he became the legislator in chief. And whatever the Supreme Court does with it, the passing of health care reform was historic. The passing of financial reform was historic. The stimulus, which wasn't big enough, was, and might have been composed differently, was essential to keep the country from descending and the world from descending into a depression. You could go through a whole series of achievements. I mean, historians who have been talking about this say that no one who's a progressive president since Lyndon Johnson has had this kind of impact and this kind of record. He didn't close Guantanamo. He can't close Guantanamo, and anybody who thinks he can, he can't. The Congress won't let him. He's made deals. I don't believe that last summer, if he had simply said, go ahead, we're going to default, because I'm not going to agree with you on extending the debt ceiling, he would be a hopeless case for reelection, and progressives would be in hopeless disrepute. Who wants to be the first president of the United States to preside over the loss of the full faith and credit of America? Would have been a disaster. And some of the deals he's made that people denounced were great deals. I mean, at the end of 2010, having been shellacked in the midterms with a lame duck Congress, he makes a great deal. Yeah, he extends the Bush tax cuts for 2 years, but they're going to expire anyway at the end of this year. And in return, he gets the payroll tax holiday, he gets extended unemployment compensation, he gets some other tax breaks heavily directed at the middle class extended. And you have to ask yourself, had he not done that, where would the American economy be today? So this always happens. The people who, and then I'm going to shut up, but this is a particular big moi for me. You know, you can read this about Franklin Roosevelt coming from progressives. You know, this guy's a great disappointment. And then, of course, he dies and he becomes a canonized saint for progressives. I mean, John Kennedy was too slow on civil rights. And in some ways he was, but he knew what he was doing. And he kept saying to King, just keep pushing, keep pushing, keep pushing. And when the time is right, I'll move. So we're not going to do, as progressives, we are not in the going to do any better than Barack Obama. I do think that, by the way, if he gets reelected, and nobody asked me this question, that Hillary Clinton will run for president in 2016. I think she'll be the nominee. I think Jeb Bush will run. I think he'll be the nominee. I'm going way out on the limb here. So I think 24 years later, we can do Clinton-Bush all over again.
That was actually my last question, but.
No, I would say, I think the Tea Party phenomenon is just totally misunderstood. There's no such thing as a Tea Party. It doesn't exist, doesn't have leaders. It's a group of conservatives. Democratic Party's always had liberals in it. Republican Party's always had conservatives in it. Tea Party is the disenchanted conservative base of the Republican Party. And part of it is a function of the disgust, rightfully so, earned by the leadership of the Republican Party for the spending profligacy. If you look at the Republican Party as a brand, people vote for Republicans historically, really, you know, for a couple reasons. You know, two of them are competence on national security, A, and then B, wise spending of the taxpayer dollars. And so one of the things that I find alarming is the rate of spending in the Obama administration. But if you look at the accumulation of the debt in the country, Republicans have a lot of, you know, have a lot of red ink on their hands as well. And so the base of the party is upset and angry about it, upset and angry about the legacy of the Tom DeLay Congress that abrogated all these important principles. And so the Tea Party as a brand is really a media creation. People self-identify with it, but it's not a political party. It's most certainly not a third party.
I just wanted to ask, how long do you think it will be before we have consistent, serious female candidates for president in either party?
Well, I think Hillary Clinton, I mean, she may choose not to run. I believe she will choose to run. I believe she will be the nominee. And I think that you're seeing in the Republican Party the emergence of credible women who could be considered over the next few years. And by the way, in the Democratic Party, you have other people, Kirsten Gillibrand, for example, who I think could become serious figures. But look, for Democrats and in terms of women candidates, you know, the sun tends to blot out the moon when they're both up there in the sky. And as long as Hillary Clinton is there as the possible Democratic candidate and nominee in 2016, you're not going to see many other Democrats. I'm amazed, and my wife is amazed, that when you talk to young women, I mean, 18, 19, you know, who were 14 years old when she ran in 2008, they are universally for her. They feel very strongly about it. She may not want to run, but I think that 2016 you'll see a serious, credible Democratic woman running. I don't know about the Republican Party, but there are people in the pipeline.
I think one of the interesting things about Secretary Clinton is she is by far the most admired political figure in the country, and she has huge positive numbers even amongst Republicans, and particularly amongst Republican women, and so it'll be interesting to watch over the next couple of years.
Mr. Robert mentioned a while ago about taxes, and recently George Osborne, the chancellor in Britain, has given a speech in the House of Commons about the 2012 budget and a lot of tax reforms that are going to happen this year. I was wondering, what is the U.S. planning to do in terms of tax reform, and whether they're going to be actually introducing something similar to what Chancellor George Osborne has planned?
There is not a chance in the world that the Obama administration will pursue the economic policies of George Osborne. When the conservative coalition, or lib conservative, the condom coalition, whatever they are, took power in 2010, Britain was coming out of the recession much stronger than the U.S. was. It actually had a growth rate between November of 2009 and November of 2010 of about 3%, And then as the coalition's austerity policies began to take hold, British growth has shrunk to a totally negligible level. I also would not anticipate that the president will propose cutting the top rate of tax, as Osborne did, or cutting the tax provisions that help poorer people, which is what Osborne also did with child benefit and some of the other. I used to do political work in Britain, so I know some of these issues. But there's not a chance. Look, the Brits are going to be our special relationship, special friends on foreign policy. I don't think Obama's going to follow the coalition down the anti-Keynesian road. I don't even know. Mitt Romney had a slip of the tongue, 3 weeks ago, where he said the one thing we shouldn't be doing is cutting too far, too fast. We got to do this gradually and over time, because otherwise you could drive the economy down again.
So in terms of framing this from a more global perspective and pulling a bit away from some of the domestic issues we've been talking about, I was wondering what effect, if any, this really extraordinary anti-systemic movement we're seeing manifest in the Arab Spring and also Occupy Wall Street has on the 2012 elections.
Well, I think that the Occupy Wall Street movement will be back in some form in the spring. What it looks like is anyone's guess. 2 months ago in the city of Oakland, these protests turned violent. The city hall was stormed. The protesters pulled every American flag out of the city hall and in front of a crowd of 5,000 chanting, "Burn it, burn it, burn it," they burned the American flags on the steps of city hall. And so if this movement returns in the spring and there's chaos in American cities, I think it's an enormous problem for the Democratic Party. And I think that the middle of the electorate will go nuts and it will be a big problem for the president. But I have no idea what it's gonna look like, how it's going to transform, you know, since last fall. But if you look at the Occupy Wall Street movement, and the trajectory that it started last fall, it certainly has helped shape the debate in a very significant way that we're having in the presidential election on all of these issues around the concept of fairness.
I think a lot of the support for Occupy Wall Street has gone away in the sense that people think they've made their point. The 99% and the 1% are out there as big issues. I agree with Steve, they contributed to that. But the paradoxical effect of that is the people who still want to do it tend to be the more extreme people. You know, there are folks in New York who still revere Leon Trotsky, and they're desperate to make their point. And now maybe they can make their point, and they can burn American flags, and they can do all of this. My guess is that they won't be very effective and that you won't see a lot of Oaklands. If you did, it would be a big problem for the Democratic Party. The larger point I would make, not about them, not even about the Arab Spring, is we now do have the capacity because of social media to see the rise of spontaneous political and social movements. And these are not the last, these are the first. We're going to see more and more of these over time.
So over the last maybe 20 years, the Jewish lobby has been one of the major players in American politics. And this election, it seems like most of the pro-Israeli subject is being packaged within the Iran conflict. But that sort of ignores the fact that they were a driving force before the whole issue with Iran came up. So I was hoping you guys could talk a little bit about how the Jewish lobby is playing in.
Well, first of all, I hate the term Jewish lobby. Let me just be honest.
Makes two of us.
I think that AIPAC, if that's what you're talking about, is a group of people who, and I've spoken to them on occasion, and I don't happen to share all their views on Israel, but the group of people who advocate and tend to support a very hardline approach by the Israelis are very close, for example, to Prime Minister Netanyahu. There's another group called J Street, which is much closer to the views that Ehud Barak at least used to represent when he was prime minister, which is that you need to move forward to a settlement, and that to get a settlement, you're going to have to make huge territorial concessions and give back parts of the old city of Jerusalem. There is a misunderstanding in a lot of the world about this issue. Israel is not popular in the United States because of a Jewish lobby, so-called. Israel is widely popular in the United States with Americans. And it's widely popular for historical reasons, consciousness of the Holocaust, because Israel is seen as a reliable ally of the United States, and because it's a small country that people think or believe has fought hard for its independence. At the same time, I think you have to give administrations credit, and I would go back to the first President Bush, President Clinton, more in the second term than the first President, the second President Bush, and Barack Obama, for trying with to deal with the Israelis in a way that moves the process toward peace. This hurt George H.W. Bush. Bill Clinton really pushed hard. Mm-hmm. And, you know, on the last day of his term, I mean, there was a Camp David Taba agreement. The myth that there wasn't is ridiculous. I read it. I saw it. On the last day of his term, Yasser Arafat called him to say, "I thank you, Mr. President, you're a very great man." And as Clinton recounts in his memoirs, he said, "I'm not a great man. I was going to be a great man, but you prevented me from being a great man because I got you a deal that got you almost all of the territory back, got you half or two-thirds of the old city, got you compensating territory elsewhere, and dealt with the right of return by compensating people. And there is no better deal, and you wouldn't sign it." So I don't think it was a pleasant conversation. But I think to understand the American relationship, and I know I'm talking too long, but that was a very provocative question. To understand the American relationship with Israel, you have to understand that it is not rooted in the sinister power of a Jewish lobby. It is rooted in things much deeper than that.
And with that, thanks to you all. Reiner, are you going to close?